Whenever there is a Batman discourse, sometimes there's a lot of confusion about nihilism and existentialism, so just to clarify, nihilism is...
人說這個世界有種雀仔無腳，只可以一直這樣飛啊飛，飛到攰嗰陣就喺啲風入邊瞓覺，鷹雀仔一世只可以落地一次，好似就係佢死嘅時候。
And existentialism is the big baby in 2001. So existentialism is this philosophical movement by these mega chads, Nietzsche, Kierkegaard, Schopenhauer, Sartre, etc. They tried to figure out if we could persist in a world that doesn't make sense, the distance between eternity and oblivion is increasingly slim, and there are over 85 flavors of Oreo. Kierkegaard suggested a leap of faith, Schopenhauer liked hedgehogs, and Nietzsche, well, he was kind of the big baby guy. He quite accurately predicted that in a post-Scottish-dead world, becoming a bird without legs would seem like an increasingly sexy option. So he gave us a pretty famous solution, the Übermensch, or the Superman. We conquer meaninglessness by mastering ourselves and creating our own sense of values. Authenticity. Living for the dream that is yours and yours alone, so you can abandon the spirit of gravity. Anyways, this is a video about that time Christopher Nolan made Bane sound like this.
They expect one of us in the wreckage, brother.
And Talia al Ghul was a white French woman?
Talia.
Robin was just cop Joseph Gordon Levitt because his first name was literally Robin.
I like that name. Robin.
Thanks. Why are we even worrying?
But I guess it's better than laundry karate. Batman 2020 was pretty great. I mean, he did that thing with the blueberry, his jaw was very jaw-like, but most importantly for me, my part of the internet decided that he, one, ate shredded cheese out of the bag, and two, needed a child to babysit. Him, he needed a child to babysit him. And this is a pretty new phenomenon because I think for a lot of us, in a lot of movies, we seem to just really hate Robin with a burning passion and make him cop Joseph Gordon-Levitt. And so, as the Robin expert, of course, I've decided that these ideas come down to about three arguments. One, Robin is useless and annoying, which I guess is fair. Two, Robin doesn't really fit into a dark, gritty, and existential Batman story. And number three, well, I guess it's just the homophobia. Yeah. Homophobia. In 1940, the boy wonder was born to Bill Finger and Jerry Robinson in Detective Comics number 38. And in those 82 years, there have been many Robin. We got Dick Grayson, Jason Todd, Carrie Kelly, Stephanie Brown, Tim Drake, Damian Wayne, and the love of my life, Duke Thomas. And every Robin has a really tragic backstory of neglectful or dead parents, and before Batman takes them and trains them in the ways of destructive coping mechanisms. Fighting crime. While people in the Bat fandom, they just attribute the numerous amount of Bat children to Batman's innate dad impulse that gets triggered by any orphans with black hair, there's actually a really deep philosophical and just a touching reason as to why there's so many. I'm joking, Bill Finger just wanted to give Batman someone to talk to. Because Sherlock without a Watson is just a guy with a big brain and a lot of cocaine, and Batman without Robin is just a theater kid?
Jim, do you know what he's doing? T-posing. What's that mean? Twisted is dominance.
Oh, I almost forgot. DC just wanted us to give them money. Because Batman was the existential modernist figure. A mix of pulp heroes of Zorro, the Scarlet Pimpernel, Sherlock Holmes, and Dick Tracy. He was as masculine as anything written by Hemingway, and as murderous as anything written by Zack Snyder. And while this appealed to all the alpha edgelords out there, this wasn't really huge with moms and kids alike. Enter Robin, who, armed with only some puns and a pair of pixie boots, doubled Batman's styles, numbers, and changed comics forever, if the subsequent slew of kid sidekicks and pets is any relevant metrics for success. So let's please give a moment of silence for Zook. Zook. But as Robin changed comics, he also changed Batman. A fairly derivative character became layered. Bruce Wayne went through the same trauma in his life. He saw in Robin what happened to him. They worked together, they trained together, and Robin was born. Now armed with empathy and batarangs, Batman comics subverted all the typical stuff in a brooding vigilante comic. Just Rights has a really excellent video detailing why hypermasculine characters in fiction become dads so often to progress their character arcs, but heck, Batman makes it work because Robin is such a subversive
character foil. In any narrative, a foil is a character who contrasts with another character. Typically, a character who contrasts with the protagonist in order to better highlight or differentiate certain qualities of the protagonist. A foiled protagonist may also be the antagonist of the plot. Wikipedia from the Wikipedia.
For example, Joker, nihilism. Two-Face, nihilism. Riddler, nihilism green. Clayface, theater kid, and Poison Ivy, I guess, is just green. And okay, Robin also contrasts Batman nihilism, but not in the same way that his villains do. Because Robin isn't just a foil for Batman, he's also a foil for Bruce Wayne. Batman, because he's trapped in comic books, faces endless existential battles against a city that is impossible to save. Quote, my war has been a lonely one. At times I felt swallowed up by it. Wallow in mud, you end up dirty. Because in the face of impossible odds, Robin ensures Bruce Wayne's humanity, no matter what. And in turn, Batman gives Robin closure, way past that sacrifice, and with that, the little things. He could be better. A hero forged in light. Robin is not Batman, but too much. He is who Bruce Wayne could be. A boy does not spend his life looking backwards, who can save his city without dying himself. Horatio, not Hamlet. A hero forged in light. So, what happened? If he's a functional character, how did Robin become pulp culture's laziest punchline? Last year in an issue from Batman Urban Legends, Tim Drake, Robin number 3, came out as bisexual. And though I could easily say this is another cynical, tokenizing marketing move by DC, the more naive and optimistic part of me would like to say that this is one of the most significant issues in DC's history. Because in 1954, the comics industry underwent a massive change with the release of Dr. Friedrich Wertheim's Seduction of the Innocent. The central thesis was that comics were dangerous and legitimate cause of juvenile delinquency. So basically, won't someone think of the children? The book. He famously cited Batman and Robin's relationship to be a potential cause of gay. Bruce Wayne is he's German. Bruce Wayne is described as a socialite, and the official relationship is that Dick is Bruce's ward. They live in sumptuous quarters with beautiful flowers and large vases and have a butler, Alfred. Batman is sometimes shown in a dressing gown as they sit by the fireplace. The young boy sometimes worries about his partner. Already in the midst of the Lavender Scare, the book caused a moral outcry that further entrenched the gay man as a predator trope and the public's understanding of Batman and Robin. Comics and their heroes needed to adapt if they were to survive, and boy did they. Please check out Lola Sebastian's amazing video about Call Me By Your Name for a really excellent exploration of homophobic moral panics. But before 2020 canonized Batman's explicitly bisexual aesthetic, Batman and Robin were to be as straight as possible. Robin's narrative role was really filled by women in the future, and their comics and their on-screen adaptations underwent a massive tonal shift. Because suddenly, it was time for Batman to be realistic. Which brings us to Jason Todd became the second Robin in 1983, and he was not popular. First, fans criticized the fact that he had a pretty much identical backstory to that of Dick Grayson, but when they eventually changed his backstory and his personality to be more aggressive and brash and bratty, everybody, including his writers, hated Jason Todd. Conspicuously, in 1981, the United States reported its first case of HIV and AIDS. It took 6 years and too many lives before Ronald Reagan ever mentioned the words HIV/AIDS. 1987 saw the release of the Presidential Commission of the HIV Epidemic. The report went largely ignored. As of 2021, 33.6 million people have died, not only because of government action, but rather because of government inaction. Because HIV disproportionately affected gay communities, the disease was moralized. Entire groups were discriminated against, and suddenly the right to life became nothing more than a peripheral footnote. It is thus no surprise that in 1988, when fans were given the power to determine whether Robin, a character who was queer-coded or at least perceived to be queer, lived or died, Jason Todd. A Death in the Family, written by Jim Starlin and penciled by Jim Aparo and Mike Mignola, killed Jason Todd. Jason, after being fired by Batman for his erratic behavior, travels to Lebanon in search of his real mother. And it doesn't go well. She betrays him to the Joker, and he dies, protecting her. But initially the idea was that Jason was gonna die of HIV and AIDS, so I guess that's better. Quote, DC had this great idea, and they put it in the suggestion box and said, which character should we give AIDS to? And we'll do a special story. I stuffed it with Robins. Every day I was sticking Robins in there, but they recognized my handwriting, they threw all the Robins out, and Jimmy Olsen won. And then they found out the actor who plays Jimmy Olsen in the Superman movies was gay, and they abandoned the whole project. So instead, DC put the fate of Robin into the hands of fans. And ironically, Frank Miller, who just killed Robin in The Dark Knight Returns, said it was, quote, the most cynical thing that particular publisher had ever done. But as cynical as it was, it worked. It made a lot of money, and it remains today to be one of the most popular Batman comics. In fact, it is one of those comics that directors always said they like to adapt or that they took inspiration from. You know, you got your Batman Year Ones, your Long Halloweens, The Dark Knight Returns, and A Death in the Family. Here's the thing. I'm not sure this comic is actually that great. Notably, it's really horribly racist. It generalizes Muslims, Arabs, and Iranians into a singular group, then presents them to be terrorists and makes them team up with the Joker. Quote, the Joker's insanity is their insanity. His destructiveness is their destructiveness. Batman's arch enemy finds his home with our Arabs and Iranians, America's enemies. So really the only thing we can praise this comic for is how it developed Batman's character. The Batman, for him to be the Ubermensch, he must be free of gravity. He must be the big baby. And he must be the big baby alone. Quote, the concept of greatness entails being noble, wanting to be by oneself, being able to be different, standing alone, and having to live independently. And though I hate to say it, Robin is kind of a manic pixie dream girl. Because once you make a character dependent on that person for character development, the next logical step would be to remove that manic pixie dream girl and see what the main character does without them. But Jason's not like other girls. He dies in fiery, fiery explosions.
Real hot girl shit.
Pushing Batman to have his existential struggle alone is simply good ubermanchy character development. So we've been killing, removing, or ignoring Robins ever since. So in my opinion, A Death in the Family, the quality doesn't really lie in the comic itself. We ignore the racism and the homophobia because of what a death of a Robin means to a Batman. Because in combination with The Killing Joke, all that Frank Miller stuff, and Tim Burton's Batman 1989, Death in the Family reestablished the dark, gritty, and realistic tone of a Batman story. A good Batman story does not need Robin to fight against nihilism. Well, unless you're Zack Snyder. And while Joel Schumacher's films are not perfect, they're campy and there is queer subtext. They're not dark, they're not gritty, and they're not real, but that's not what makes them bad. Important to consider that realism is more often than not a homogenizing depiction of society's dominant set of values. Realism can often be a synonym for whiteness and heteronormativity. So when we alter Robin to the point of unrecognizability or avoid him entirely for the sake of tonal consistency, are we making a realistic Batman movie or reinforcing the parameters of what we deem to be acceptable and worthy of being real? So if Robin is still absurd in 2022, maybe Batman should be. Albert Camus did not really consider himself to be an existentialist, nor really as a philosopher, but his idea of absurdism and the absurd are generally considered to be branches of existentialism. He said that life was meaningless, irrational, and replete with suffering, but somehow we can remain lucid and aware of the absurd without giving up. Once we discover the absurd, we get two choices, death or recovery, and two methods to make this decision, the method of La Palice and the method of Don Quixote. Solely the balance between evidence and lyricism can allow us to achieve simultaneously emotion and lucidity. Personally, I think Batman chose the Don Quixote route. Miguel de Cervantes' Don Quixote goes a little something like this. So there's this guy. He's obsessed with classic tales of knights and chivalry, and in the middle of his midlife crisis, he takes on the name Don Quixote and decides to become a knight errant with a mission to vanquish evil and protect the innocent. He chooses Dulcinea, a peasant who he decides is actually a princess, who he will fight for in her honor. On his travels, he meets this laborer dude called Sancho Panza and convinces him to become a squire. Then they go on a bunch of wacky adventures, like thinking windmills are giants and wearing a wash basin as a helmet. So the saga finally ends with Don Quixote falls ill, renounces the fallacy of chivalry, and reveals his true name is Alonso Quianco, all the while with Sancho by his side. Nothing inherently makes Don Quixote and Batman special. Their only true power lies in their ability to see the potential greatness in the world around them. And this connection is likely spurious and compounded by the necessity of episodic evergreen storytelling. The big baby thing is probably stronger. But the thing about Übermensch and our response to nihilism in general is that we listen to the Smiths and make Joseph Gordon-Levitt Robin because we're cool and we're geniuses and we figure something out that nobody else has. But honestly, that's a lot of the time it's a recipe for loneliness. Existential loneliness makes for a great Übermensch, but Batman recovering from trauma by building a family in the process, that honestly just feels a lot more heroic to me. I choose to see Batman as an absurd hero with an absurd sidekick, and they fight above all else for the dreams of others. Death may be a bird with no legs, but Batman and Robin, together they are proof that hope, to steal from Emily Dickinson, is also a thing with feathers.
Why do we fall, sir?
I leave Sisyphus at the foot of the mountain. One always finds one's burden again. But Sisyphus teaches the higher fidelity that negates the gods and raises rocks. He too concludes that all is well. This universe henceforth without a master seems to him neither sterile nor futile. Each atom of that stone, each mineral flake of that night that filled the mountain, in itself forms a world. The struggle itself towards the heights is enough to fill a man's heart.
So that we can learn to pick ourselves up.
One must imagine Sisyphus happy.